Welcome this evening to the holiest of holy nights, where we celebrate the birth of the Christ child. On behalf of the congregation session and the pastoral staff of First Presbyterian, we welcome you this evening to this inspiring and wonderful Christmas Eve service, and may we in advance wish you a very Merry Christmas. God bless.
This Advent, we have had the audacity to be on the lookout for the arrival of a baby in a manger who will one day will reign in glory. The four Advent candles signal a renewal of our trust in the amazing grace of God's promise of the coming of a Savior. One candle alerts us to hope for the future return of Christ. Another candle urges us to prepare the way of the Lord. A third candle calls us to be anointed by the Holy Spirit. The fourth candle to experience the joy of the glad tidings of a Savior. Today we light the Christ candle to celebrate the birth of the one who redeems the world. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. Let us walk in the light of the Christ. On this Christmas Eve, we light the candle of Christ, who became flesh and lived among us so that we might become people of light.
Brothers and sisters, let us call our hearts and minds together in worship. Christ is born, give him glory. Christ has come down from heaven, receive him. Christ is now on earth, exalt him. O earth, sing to the Lord. O you nations, praise him in joy, for he has been glorified. In repentance, let us call ourselves to confession, followed by our shared prayer of confession, uniting our voices as one, and then followed by your own time of silent reflection. Like a great light in a land of deep darkness, the mercy of Christ shines on us. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sins. God of grace and truth, in Jesus Christ, you came among us as a light shining in darkness. We confess that we have not welcomed the light or trusted good news to be good. We have closed our eyes to glory in our midst, expecting little and hoping for less. Forgive our doubt and renew our hope so that we may receive the fullness of your grace and live in the truth of Christ the Lord. Brothers and sisters, receive the good news, the assurance of our forgiveness. Christ, our Savior, gives himself for us, redeeming us from our sin and claiming us as his own people. Hear the promise of God. See, your salvation has come. You are a holy people, redeemed by God, sought out and not forsaken. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Our first scripture this evening is from Isaiah, the 9th chapter, beginning with verse 2. Please listen for a word from our Lord. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them a light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given us. Authority rests upon his shoulders. He is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness, from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
From the prophecy of Jeremiah, chapter 23, verses 5 and 6. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness.
Thank you. A reading from the prophet Micah, 5th chapter, verses 2 through 5a. But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace.
Our fourth reading is from Luke chapter 1, beginning with verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph. He was of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and he said, "Greetings, favored one." But Mary was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing is impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
Thank you.
the birth of Jesus the Messiah, according to the Gospel of St. Matthew. Now the birth of Jesus the Messiah took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, who said, "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife. But he had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and Joseph named him Jesus.
Thank you.
A reading from John chapter 1, verses 1 through 9, followed by verse 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. Now there was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth.
Our reading is from Luke chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus to all the world that should be registered. This was first registration and was taken while Quintus was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David, called Bethlehem. He was a descendant from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver that child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bonds of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
Angels, according to St. Luke. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. For see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom God favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste, and they found Mary and Joseph, and the child lying in a manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary, she treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told to them.
Friends, I don't know for sure. I don't know for sure if the story I'm going to tell you actually happened. But I know its message is true. There was a high-energy, rambunctious boy who was known for going off script during his church's annual Christmas pageants. When he was one of the sheep, he could be heard baaing, baa. When he was a cow, he mooed like a cow. When he was an angel, he kept flapping his wings. And when he was a shepherd, well, let's just say there were regrets that he was issued a shepherd's crook in the first place. Now, the year arrived that the boy was of an age where he was old enough to have a speaking part in the pageant. And it was decided that the safest option was to have him be the innkeeper. Yes, the innkeeper. He only had to open a door, say no, when Joseph asked if there was room, and then close the door. Open the door, no, close the door. All during rehearsals, the boy did his role as the innkeeper perfectly, without a hitch. The night of the pageant, Mary and Joseph arrived at the inn and knocked on the door. The innkeeper opened the door, and when Joseph asked if there was room, the innkeeper said no, and then closed the door. I don't know how much theater experience you may have, but very often the final production feels so much more real than the rehearsal, which may explain. It may explain why, as Mary and Joseph walked away from the inn, the door slowly opened again. Out stepped the innkeeper. And with tears streaming down his face, this high-energy, rambunctious boy, known for going off script, called out to a very startled Mary and Joseph, "No, wait! Come back! We'll make room for you!" Yes, he had gone off script, rather boldly too, but he had gone off script trying to make room for Jesus. Somehow this off-script moment captured the spirit of Christmas more perfectly than one might imagine. Let every heart prepare him room. How willing are we? How ready are we to go off script? To go off script from worldly expectations in order to do the heavenly work of making room in our hearts for the birth of the Christ child, the heavenly work of making room in our hearts for that child to grow up and to so guide us into a future of what we say and think and do. Maybe we will be more willing and more ready when we realize how God goes off script from worldly expectations to do the heavenly work of Emmanuel, God with us, in the birth of the Christ child. God has a way of going off script in ways that surprise us and make us new people like that. Frederick Buechner puts it this way: those who believe in God can never in a way be sure of him again. Once they have seen him in a stable, they can never be sure where God will appear or what lengths God will go or to what ludicrous depths of self-humiliation God will descend in God's wild pursuit of humankind. If holiness and the awful power and majesty of God were present in these least auspicious of events, this birth of a peasant's child, then there is no place or time so lowly and earthbound but that holiness can be present there too. And this means that we are never safe, that there is no place where we can hide from God, no place where we are safe from God's power to break into and recreate the human heart, because it is just where God seems most helpless that God is most strong, and just where we least expect God that God comes most fully. Let me get that money part of the quote at the end. It is just where God seems most helpless that God is most strong, and just where we least expect God, that God comes most fully. You might call it going off script in a holy way. Do you ever notice how Jesus has a soft spot in his own heart for the least likely and most vulnerable among us, that he has room in his heart for those sorts of folks. Have you ever noticed how Jesus feels it deep down in his own heart that we are ministering to him whenever we feed the hungry or quench the thirsty or welcome the stranger or clothe the naked or visit the sick or in prison? Maybe that's so because Jesus knows what it's like to be born into circumstances featuring limited options according to worldly expectations. It may well be that the key to making room enough for the Christ child in our own lives and own hearts starts with knowing there is already room enough in Christ's own heart for all God's children. Room enough, perhaps, especially when we think our options are limited according to worldly expectations. We are loved by a Savior who knows what it's like to face long odds on options according to worldly expectations, long odds from the manger to the cross. But we are loved by a Savior who goes off the world's script for who's in control by taking the rough-hewn wood of both the cradle and the cross to fashion an empty tomb. And so we are loved by a Savior who has room enough in his own heart for all God's children to experience redemption and grow into the promises of eternal life. We have a good friend. Her name is Ashley Masters. She is a college chaplain with the Presbyterian Campus Ministry of Raleigh. A few Christmas seasons ago, she went to the post office for Christmas stamps. The post office clerk told Ashley Ann that the only stamps left were, and I quote, "just the Liberty Bell and some lady holding a baby." Some lady holding a baby happened to be one of Raphael's portraits of the Madonna and Child. The world may see only some lady holding a baby, but we know better, don't we? And since we know better, we had best make room in our hearts to welcome in the Christ child, because this child will transform our hearts with love that goes to the cradle and cross for us and for all God's children. Because at any moment, we may very well encounter this child in our midst, perhaps especially in the faces of the least likely and most vulnerable. Because we need this child to grow in our hearts. We need this child to grow in our hearts at this very moment and all the moments of our lives. Let every heart prepare him room. What scripts do we need to go off to make more room in our hearts for the Christ child? Something to ponder as we celebrate Christmas this year. May it be so. Please join me in prayer. Now to the one who by the power at work within us is able to do far more abundantly than all we can ask or imagine. To God be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen.
Let us unite our hearts and minds in prayer. Let us pray. God of the starry heavens and the good earth, eternal God, God with us, you have come among us in the figure of a baby, a newborn reaching out to us to bring a smile to our lips and hope to our hearts. Thank you for the tenderness with which you touch our lives this Christmas. As we remember the baby lying in a manger, we pray for peace. Peace in all the places where there is anger or war or fear. Peace in all the hearts that know sorrow or stress. We pray for people who will not sleep safely tonight because of conflict in their lives. Cradle all these people and places in your love, so the world may sleep in heavenly peace this night. This Christmas, as we remember the Mother Mary rocking her baby, we pray for all children born this Christmas season. Watch over mothers and fathers and grandparents hoping for the best for their newborns. Inspire us to create communities where every child is valued and every family has enough. May families rejoice because Christ the Savior is born for us, for each of us, and for all of us. This Christmas, as we remember the Father Joseph protecting his little one, we pray for all those watching over the helpless and the hopeless this season. We pray that you will be with all those who must work this holiday to keep the world safe and to care for those in need. Be with those who are sick or sad or lonely, so that each one will know your tender touch. God of the starry heavens and the good earth, eternal God, God with us, this Christmas we remember the shepherds coming in haste. Open our hearts to reach out to the Christ child to receive the gift you offer us in Jesus, even as we offer our love to you in his name. Bless us in the year ahead so that we can share your love with all the lives that touch ours. And as we receive our gifts tonight, we pray that you will bless, yes, that you will even multiply the gifts dedicated to crisis assistance ministry and to SOCS for the feeding and care of those in need in Gaston County. May our hearts sing with the Christmas angels, glory to you, O God, and on earth, peace for all who wonder at your love. Hear our prayers as we pray together the prayer we have been taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. We do remember that Christmas is a time of gift giving. You may send a check to the church earmarked for the crisis ministry and SOCS, your Christmas Eve offering, or you may make your contribution online at fpcgastonia.org. That is fpcgastonia.org/online giving. Remember, the Lord loves a cheerful giver, and 100% of tonight's offering is split between CAM and SOCS for the benefit of those less fortunate. Each gift is a piece of hope waiting to change someone's life.
The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it, does not overcome it, and never shall overcome it. Follow this light. Let this light take you to Bethlehem to see the birth of him who the angels sing. Take this light and follow it to Bethlehem with hearts wide open, knowing that before you ever arrive, the heart of the Christ child has you and everyone you know in there too. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you and grant you peace, now and always. Merry Christmas. Amen.